Welcome and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Leslie Tso, and I am the deputy to the U.S. Ambassador Daniel Shapiro. On behalf of the U.S. Embassy in Israel and the Keren Kayemet Israel Jewish National Fund USA, I am honored to welcome you all here for this important event. I arrived in Israel only about a month ago, and I feel very privileged that this is a meaningful ceremony and that it is one of my first official duties here. Please all rise for the presentation of the colors by the U.S. Marine Detachment and the singing of the Star Spangled Banner by Julia Gulager, accompanied by Muriel Hoffman. Please remain standing for a moment of silence. Please be seated. Ambassador Shapiro, Mr. Ronald Lauder, Mr. Mike Nitzan, Deputy Minister Ambassador Michael Oren, Mayor Nir Barkat, Deputy Director General Ambassador Jeremy Isakharov, Major General Zohir Zvir, Diplomatic Corps, including our colleagues from the American Embassy and the U.S. Consulate General, families of terror victims, rescue and fire and police officials, and distinguished guests. We stand here today at the Jewish National Fund Keren Kayemet Leisrael's 9/11 Living Memorial, designed by artist Eliezer Weishoff, who honors us with his presence today, and architect Yahiel Cohen. Today, at this inspiring monument, we mark the 15th anniversary of the horrific attacks on New York and Washington and the downing of the plane in Pennsylvania. On that day, almost 3,000 innocent people from a staggering 61 countries were killed. A horrific tragedy for our nation, the world, and so many loving families and friends. The shock of 9/11 still remains a powerful memory, and recent terror attacks in the U.S., Israel, Europe, and around the world make today's anniversary immediate and painfully relevant. We are honored to have with us today family members who lost loved ones on 9/11. For you, every day is a memorial day, and today in particular we embrace you, give you strength, and derive strength from you. We are honored too to welcome the 50-member Police Unity Tour delegation, their founder and chairman Patrick Montour, and their hosts from the Israeli National Police, officers of Israel's Fire and Rescue Authority, and representatives from first responder and victim support organizations also join us. First responders showed us all how to be true heroes on 9/11, and they continue to protect citizens every day, year after year. Also with us today are groups from JNFuture, Nefesh B'Nefesh, a large delegation from Young Judea, and representatives from both our embassy and consulate general communities. For the first time today, this ceremony is being live streamed for all who are not able to be with us today. It is now my honor to call upon Mr. Ronald Lauder, chairman of the Jewish National Fund USA and president of the World Jewish Congress, to speak on behalf of the JNFUSA.
Mayor Barkat, Ambassador Dan Shapiro, families of 9/11 victims, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen. Before I start, I'd like to ask the U.S. police and firefighters to please stand and have applause, please. Also, I thank the U.S. Armed Forces for what they have done. There are some days that never go away, where the recollection of the moment is still raw and painful as the day itself. For very old Americans, it might be Pearl Harbor or the assassination of John F. Kennedy. For Israelis, it might be Yom Kippur 1973 or another assassination on November 4th, 1995. But the entire world remembers the shock, the horror, and the unbelievable sadness of September 11th, 2001. And nowhere else in the world was the act of terror understood better than here in Israel. Jews have been the targets of Islamic terror since before the country was founded in 1948. That is why Israelis still grieve for their friends in America. That is why there is a memorial to the victims of the hateful crime here in Jerusalem. This memorial, sponsored by the Jewish National Fund, is one of the only 9/11 memorials outside the United States with all 2,996 names of the victims. Some of these names come from countries that have no diplomatic relations with Israel, where the citizens are not even permitted to associate with Israelis. We saw that full force recently at the Olympics. But they are all here. Everyone is remembered, no matter their country, their religion, or their race. They're all here. The same mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters, husbands, and wives. That's because Israel sees all people as human beings, no matter what their governments say or do. And that gets to the memorial at the heart of it and why it's here in Jerusalem. Nowhere else is there a place and a people that understand the pain and the loss felt 15 years ago in the United States. It is at this place that we understand our shared values of democracy and freedom. And we understand one more important point. Israel shares the courage demonstrated in the United States on that terrible day. It is here that Israel showed its respect and its long friendship with the people of the United States. It is here that Israel understands the hole left in the heart of families that lost dear ones on that day. 15 years have gone by, and the pain of the loss never goes away. We must learn to live with it a little better, and we have to keep on living. Supreme Court Justice Louis Brandeis once said that America's founding fathers recognized that the secret to happiness comes from freedom, and the secret of freedom comes from courage. On 9/11, the world witnessed courage that is never forgotten. The selfless courage where people ran up the stairs into a fire to save others. They were not thinking of their own families or their own lives. The firemen who climbed these stairs of the World Trade Center while everyone else was coming down. Pentagon employees who ran into the building to save others. And those brave souls on the last plane fought their attackers and saved others on the ground from death and destruction. All these people who saved others, they didn't know and would never meet. Americans showed tremendous courage on that day. That is a courage that Israelis understand. It's a courage Israel has demonstrated every single day of its existence. The soul of a free people will always rise over hate. Liberty will always triumph because people fundamentally want to be free. And the stars and stripes, along with the Star of David, will light the way for the entire world to follow. May the memory of all those names carved here at this memorial be remembered. Yes, with sadness, but also with love and devotion. May their families be comforted, and may we all live to see a better world that will never experience someday that kind of hatred and heartfelt sorrow ever again. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lauder. I now invite the Honorable Daniel Shapiro, U.S. Ambassador to Israel, to address us.
Good morning. To our friends and colleagues who are with us today in solidarity, including Israeli public officials led by Mayor Nir Barkat, I hope Deputy Minister Michael Oren, Deputy Director General of the Ministry, Michael Oren, Deputy Director General of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Jeremy Sakharov, representatives of the Diplomatic Corps, police officers from Israel and the United States, led by Major General Zohar Dvir, and representatives of the Police Unity Delegation, our colleagues from the Consulate General in Jerusalem, led by Acting Deputy Principal Officer David Burns, and to all our honored guests, thank you for coming today to offer your support and your respect on this 15th anniversary of the terrorist attacks against the United States of America on September 11th, 2001. I also want to add my thanks to Karen Kayemet Israel and JNFUSA for co-sponsoring today's ceremony and to maintaining this special, beautiful, evocative place of memorial and reflection. We come to it each year, and it's a testament to the bond between the American people and the people of Israel, and to our shared experience with tragedy. The United States has many friends, quite a few of them represented here by their diplomats, and many of them have also experienced terror and loss. But perhaps none can identify more with our pain than Israelis. So Ron Lauder and Mike Nitzan, thank you. We're truly indebted to you to have this place in Israel to remember our losses. Among the nearly 3,000 souls taken from us on 9/11 were five Israeli citizens: Alona Avraham, Leon Libol, Daniel Lewin, Shai Levenhar, and Chagai Shefi. And there may be others present with a personal connection to other victims who fell on that day. So to all the families, we embrace you, we support you, we mourn with you, we stand with you in your loss and pain today and every day. And a special word of thanks to the young people who have come today. Your presence is vital. In fact, I want to focus my remarks today on you, on the next generation. 15 years. 15 years have passed since that dreaded day. Each anniversary carries its own power, its own meaning. All of them make us deeply aware of what and who we lost and of the responsibility that memory imposes on us. But this year, in a subtle but unmistakable way, our remembrances mark the transition of 9/11 from living memory into history. If we add the first 3 years of life before lasting memories are formed, a young person on the cusp of adulthood today, whether graduating high school in the United States or enlisting in the IDF in Israel, has no personal memory of 9/11. Now, to those of us who will always remember where we were on that day, whose lives and careers were permanently altered by those events, the idea that there walk among us people, adults, who can only relate to 9/11 as a historical event, although that's a natural process of time, is nevertheless a jarring thought. Those of us who were there, who heard the rumbles of the planes and watched the buildings fall, who trembled all day and all night, not just that day, but for days and weeks after, we will never, ever forget. Those of us who prayed for our relatives, our friends, our coworkers, and our fellow Americans, our brave firefighters and police officers who came to the rescue, we will never forget. Those of us who could smell the flames, who breathed in the smoke, those of us who had to sweep up the debris and the ashes, who watched those searing images replayed over and over, we will never forget. And for those who were sent into battle in the weeks and the months and the years after, and for their families and communities, we will never forget. September 11th, 2001 is a signpost in our lives, one that can never be erased, There was a before, and there was an after. So how do we ensure that the thousands upon thousands of stories of tragedy, of terror, but also of heroism and healing are passed on to those, unlike myself and so many of you, those who have no personal memory of that day? How do we teach the next generation? How do we make it real for them? It's a question we can't fully answer yet, a question we will need to ask ourselves over and over again on this and on future anniversaries. Yes, we can commemorate as we're doing today and as this memorial will do for generations to come. Yes, we can comfort, providing what strength and support we can muster to families whose loss emanates from this day but radiates outward to affect every moment of their lives. Yes, we can document, as the 9/11 Memorial in New York is doing through its collection of testimonials, as we heard last year and we'll hear again today. Yes, we can rebuild, as we have rebuilt, both in New York and at the Pentagon. Yes, we can improve our defenses, which we have done methodically and diligently. Yes, we can counter the efforts of zealots and extremists who seek to carry out or inspire terrorism, as the United States has done together with our allies, many of whom have also been struck by terror, through an unprecedented and uninterrupted global counterterrorism campaign. And yes, we can guard our values, as President Obama said at Fort Meade last September 11th, which we do alongside, quote, our common belief that America is an indispensable force for good around the world, and that our military is a linchpin in our ability to protect our values alongside our diplomatic efforts. All of these efforts are important, and we will remain committed to them. But the next task relates to memory. Have we done enough to ensure that the next generation and future generations fully comprehend the calamity that befell us that day, the ways it changed us, and the responsibility it imposes on us? Israelis have repeatedly been faced with this question. They are a nation that has endured countless tragedies and more than one existential crisis, each of which shattered individual lives and stung an entire generation. Where Israelis have excelled, and where we continue to learn from them, is conveying the power of memory and history forward so that each successive generation understands the meaning and the obligations that flow from events which they cannot personally recall. Through national ceremonies, small graveside memorials, and a commitment to education, Israel plants seeds of understanding in those who were not there. And the result is a people that knows how to honor and grieve its losses, but also unites in common purpose to build, to serve, to protect, and to live out its most sacred values. Jewish tradition provides additional inspiration for our task. Each year, at the Pesach Seder, we are commanded to tell the story of God's liberation of the Jewish people from slavery to freedom. We are commanded, and you shall tell your child on that day. The goal is that in every generation, each person will see herself or himself as one who personally experienced the redemption. And so it is with us today. The obligation falls most heavily on the parent to teach and to tell, and I will teach and tell, but I believe it also falls on the child. So to each of you, I'm speaking to the young people here, those who do not have your own personal memories of 9/11, I urge you, ask questions, read accounts of the event, learn the history, visit the memorials in New York and Washington and Pennsylvania. talk to families to hear about their loved ones, honor the firefighters and police officers who gave everything to save others, and mindful of the obligation of the parent, I will also do my share of the telling. I want you to know about the fear that we experienced that day, not knowing from where the attacks came or what else might be in store. I want you to know about the vulnerability we felt, the shattering of our sense of innocence and sense of security, which, to my regret, we've been unable to fully restore and to provide to you. I want you to know about the deep, heavy sadness, a sorrow that I've never known, that hung over our nation for weeks and months as the enormity of our losses and the pain of the family sunk in. But I also want you to know about some other, more surprising things we felt, some drawn from my own story. On that day, I was at work on Capitol Hill, which we learned later was the likely target of the fourth plane, United Flight 93. Once the passengers and crew understood what was happening and what had already happened on the other doomed flights, they courageously fought back and, against all odds, managed to steer our nation away from further tragedy. Even as they perished and their families suffered irreparable losses, they saved others. I might have been among those they saved. So in addition to pain and loss and fear, I and so many Americans experienced incredible gratitude. Each year at this memorial, I try to spend a little time with the heroes of Flight 93, whose names are etched on this memorial, to thank them. Others have similar stories of inspiration about first responders, colleagues, ordinary citizens, and later the men and women of our military who served and gave and even died to keep others safe. The bravery and service and spirit that was exhibited through these events continues to inspire us to seize every moment to do and give and serve and build. Rosh Hashanah, the new year, is approaching. It is also known as Yom HaZikaron, or the Day of Remembrance. Let us use the power of memory, whether our own or those passed down to us, to inspire us to overcome tragedy and loss and build a brighter future and a safer world. Thank you, and Shana Tova to all of you.
Thank you, Ambassador Shapiro. Mr. Mike Nitzan, Deputy Chairman of Karen Kayemet Le'Israel Jewish National Fund, will now deliver his remarks.
There is an American composer by the name of Aaron Copland, who wrote a piece called A Fanfare for the Common Man. Generally, these speeches are preceded by long lists of the honorees and the distinguished individuals, but I think that Aaron Copland and his Fanfare for the Common Man is a theme for this day, because terror, fear, and evil do not distinguish between status. They do not distinguish between rich or poor. They do not distinguish between nationality, religion, belief. We are all one in the face of pure evil. The events of 15 years ago was the most awesome expression of pure evil in the last century, in this century. And we talk about 100 years, we talk about 15 years, but the place we're standing has known for thousands of years the confrontation between evil and justice and right. So as we speak today and we gather today, we are all common people. We all share a common fate. We all share a common responsibility to maintain right in the face of evil and terror, which seeks to shake the foundations of our society and our culture, of everything that we know as good and beautiful. 15 years ago, the Keren Kayemet Yisrael, the Jewish National Fund, celebrated 100 years of its existence, of land reclamation, project development, environmentalism, sustainability, connecting the spirit and the land of Israel to the Jewish people to create a state, to lay the foundations of that state. As the ambassador stated, we are here basically to remember and to speak to the people up in the rafters there of what the task that lays before us is. If you look around momentarily, you'll see something a little bit ironic. You'll see that this is a green spot that remains in the heart of a fire. There was a massive fire here recently, and everything was burned more or less except this one place. The concept of greenery and the trees bring me to trying to bring some excerpts of Nitzan Zach, the Israeli poet, from a song I will share with you. We are as of the tree of the field. Like us, the tree blossoms and grows. As the tree, we are uprooted, cut down. We do not know where we have been or where we will be, like the tree of the field. Like the tree, we aspire upward. Like us, the tree burns in fire. We have loved and hated, tasted of both. Burned in a field of ashes, bitter, bitter in the mouth, like the tree of the field. If we begin to speak of ashes and we begin to see the images of what happened 15 years ago, remember that there is a sense of critical moments when you act or don't act. When you look into the fire and you look into the ashes, or you look into the elevator shaft, or you run into the cloud of dust because that's your duty, those are your friends, and those are the people you have a responsibility to. Or in other circumstances, in other places, with a friend next to you, all of a sudden leaps and throws his body on a grenade in order to save his soldiers. And you see it happen next to you. And you wonder what drives people to do these things. A sense of right, a sense of obligation, a sense of responsibility, or doing the right thing that we were taught to do in those critical moments. Those seconds that separate life from death, those critical opportunities where the common man or woman makes a decision to risk him or herself for the sake of someone else. That is the right and the truth that binds us all in the face of utter evil. As the ambassador said, there have been people who were born on this day 15 years ago who are reaching a certain cognitive, emotional level and forming their identity of who they want to be, where they want to be, where they want to invest themselves. The Karen Kayemet is committed to connecting all elements of the Jewish people to its historical homeland, an active, experiential involvement in building this land. We asked about how to ensure the memories and make those memories living. The only way that I know how to do that is by firsthand experience, and I don't wish any of you to ever have to look down in the face of cruelty or evil. But I invite you to continue to build the links and the common connections that we all share to pursue the right, the good, the beautiful, to make sure that trees and people continue to blossom as a shared and mutual responsibility for preserving a healthy society and a healthy earth. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Julia Guliger will now sing Rikmat Enoshet Ahat. We are all made as a single living human tapestry, accompanied by Muriel Hoffman, lyrics and music by Madi Hammer. Thank you, Julia and Muriel. I am honored to invite Zvi Levenhar to to recite Kaddish in the name of all the families. Tzvi son Shai, may his memory be a blessing. Worked at the World Trade Center and was killed on 9/11, leaving his young family and infant daughter. Please rise for Kaddish.
Toda. אני אגיד את הקדיש בשם ארבעת הישראלים שנהרגו, אלונה אברהם, דן לוין, שי לוין הבני וחגי שפי, וכמובן כל השלושת אלפים אנשים. התגדל והתקדש מרבה, בעלמה דיברה חירותי והמליך מלכותי, בחיי חון ובמכון ובחיי דכל בית ישראל, בעגלה ובזמן קריב ואמרו אמן. יהי שמי רבה מבורך לעולם ולעולמי עולמיה. יתברך וישתבח ויתפאר ויתרומם ויתנשא ויתהדר ויתעלה ויתעלל שמי דקודשה בריחו. לעילה ולעילה מן כל ברכתה ושירתה, תושבחתה ונחמתה, דאמירן בעלמה ואמרו אמן. יהי שלמה רבה מן שמיה וחיים טובים עלינו ועל כל ישראל ואמרו אמן. עושה שלום במרומיו וברחמיו יעשה שלום עלינו ועל כל עמו ישראל, ואמרו אמן. תודה.
Please be seated. The Police Unity Tour organization raises public awareness of law enforcement officers who have died in the line of duty in the United States. I am honored to call upon Police Unity Tour member Detective Sergeant Benjamin Salerno of the Perth Amboy, New Jersey Police Department to deliver his remarks.
Good morning. I apologize, I don't have anything formal written down, so what you're gonna get is a recollection from the heart and from the mind. I wanna thank everybody for their hospitality you've shown us over the past couple days. It's amazing. A year ago, I don't think there was ever a thought that my sisters and brothers would be here to share and participate in such an honorable event, not only the 9/11 ceremony, but to commemorate the passing of the lives of your members lost in the line of duty. As we spoke about the past couple days, it doesn't make a difference if you live 5 minutes away, 5 blocks, or 5,000 miles. You guys hurt, we hurt. You bleed, you cry, we cry. We're one family. And so thank you. What you've shown us is incredible. September 11, 2001, some of us can't recall what we had for dinner 2-3 days ago, or maybe what we did last weekend, but I'm sure everybody in attendance, for those that were born at that time frame, can recall vividly what they were doing, what they heard, and the accounts as they happened. I'm going to share with you a piece of that. Richie Rodriguez was a Port Authority police officer assigned to the Port Authority Police Department, their training academy, their police academy. His office was right outside the Holland Tunnel in the Port Authority Technical Center, literally 2 minutes from the tunnel, probably 6 or 7 minutes without traffic on a normal New York day to the towers. When the first incident happened in 1993, Richie was a newly appointed police officer there, so he was part of that event, sadly, as well. When the events unfolded, back in the day, everybody's technological savvy. We had the Nextels, the two-way radios with the antenna that pulls up and whatnot. And we had called Richie and says, hey, what's going on? He says, I don't know. He says, we realized that it was more than an errant plane, you know, medical emergency. You know, we had the report of the second plane that now went into the building. So Richie, along with his academy staff, responded over to the Twin Towers. And Richie, like many hundreds of others, as people were running out, as the gentleman alluded to earlier, he went running in. And not by my account, not because of his nearness and dearness to me, but by the survivors' accounts, many accounts, he was credited with saving people, getting them out of the building. And each time that happened and he made sure they were put to safety, he went back in. Richie was a newlywed, had bought a house. Him and his wife, Cindy, were in the process of rehabilitating the house and, you know, planning their future and their family. Weren't even in their new house yet. We're still living in the apartment when this occurred. And Richie unselfishly ran back into the building time and time again. Richie was in the North Tower. For those that recall, that was the tower with the large spire on top when that tower came down. Cindy couldn't get in touch with Richie that day, so she was reaching out for us. We were in our command center in the police department, and we tried making the communication. The kind of person that Richie was, a community-based person, service person, if he was able to call his wife, he absolutely would have. as the day went on and as we saw the events and smelled and, you know, saw the smoke in the distance and everything else, we knew the reality was that he wasn't coming home. Cindy was relentless with wanting to go into New York, wanted to go find him. We were as well. We spent several days there, and we worked on that pile, and that's not something, you know, when you have a traumatic event in your life, you kind of put it past you. You don't talk about it. It's just something you don't do. But we went there, and we were dug in that pile. And our hope was that we were going to move some stuff, brush him off, and lift him out and say, come on, you've been here a couple days. But we knew that wasn't a reality. We flew down. His parents were in Puerto Rico, too ill to make the trip up for his services, so we had a full honors funeral for him in November. And it wasn't until January where his remains were positively identified through DNA. So sadly, the reality we knew was now a reality. We move on and we move forward, but we never forget. And we remember the sacrifices that not only him, but all the others have made. I'd like to recognize my best friend, who's here today, Jimmy Lisi from the Police Unity Tour, Jersey City Police Department. He was Richie's brother-in-law. So, you know, we talk about this, and Jimmy, your brother-in-law was a tremendous guy. So, in Richie's memory and all those others, may they rest in peace. Thank you.
Thank you, Benjamin. And now, through the courtesy of the 9/11 Memorial and Museum in New York City, we will hear a recording of New York police officer Scott Strauss. As a member of the New York City Police Department's Emergency Services Unit, Scott helped rescue a Port Authority policeman who was buried in the rubble of the World Trade Center. Please listen now to his moving testimony.
I'm crawling down into this hole, Patty's behind me, and we're going around beams that are hot. Fire is coming up from the other side. It's smoke-filled. We're coughing. We're choking. I'm saying to myself, to my kids, I love you. I'm sorry I'm doing this because I'm going to die. Will and John were buried and buried deep. The area that we had to crawl into to get to Will was no bigger than the area underneath a chair. Now, I crawl down and I feel that there's this cinder block wall. Part of a cinder block wall is pinning Will's left leg, his femur, down to whatever is underneath him. I can't scratch away. It feels like another cement slab, probably a floor. I don't know, but I can't move it. They send down this battery-operated jaws of life. The thing weighs about 30, 40 pounds, I guess. I get this jaws, this set of jaws, in where it needs to be. Right on the cinder block wall. But I don't know where the rest of the cinder block wall is holding up. And I don't know what's happening with the cement slab above us. I get it in place. I back out. And I go, guys, I tell Chuck and Patty. I say, guys, get out of here. Because I don't know what's going to happen. If I use this tool and it goes bad, no sense of all of us getting killed. Back out. And they weren't leaving. They said, no, we came in together. We're getting out together. Then we're not leaving. I said, okay, Will, here we go. I'm operating a tool. It cracks a piece of the cinder block out of the way. I pull it off his leg. I pass it down out of the way off of Chuck and Patty. I pass it to them. And I go, Chuck, come on, give me a hand. He's out. Being a part of that rescue helped me survive emotionally and personally. You know, that I helped somebody get home to their families. You know, I had a bright light in that dark day.
Let us now all take a moment to reflect as we hear hear Schubert's Serenade with Ayel Heyman on cello and Bella Crescent on keyboard.
Thank you.
On behalf of all of the organizers, we thank Bella Cresson, the director of the Organization for the Absorption of Immigrant Artists, for bringing us these talented young artists today. She works to integrate and employ immigrant and young musicians into Israeli cultural life. It is now my honor to invite the mayor of Jerusalem, Nir Barkat, to address us.
My friend, Ambassador Dan Shapiro, Ambassador Ron Lauder, Mike Nitzan, Deputy Chairman of KKL, Deputy Minister Michael Oren, Deputy Police Commissioner Zohar Dvir, friends that flew all over the world from America to be with us tonight, today, dear friends, families, and friends of the victims. On the morning of September 11, 2001, I landed in New York for a few days of partners meeting with my American partners. We sat on the other side of the Hudson in New Jersey, overlooking Manhattan. In the middle of the morning meeting, we heard that the Twin Towers have been hit. We went outside and saw the towers engulfed in flames, then fall. That Tuesday and the days to follow were some of the toughest and saddest days of my life. In the days that followed, I saw the grief and the pain, but also the bravery of the men and women of New York City, fighting day by day to put their city back on track. As a Jerusalemite, as an Israeli, I felt a deep, deep connection. I know this pain well. I felt it with you. Daniel Lewin, one of the members the people killed, is an American-born, Jerusalem-raised man, high-tech entrepreneur. Daniel served in the elite unit, Sayeret Matkal, of Israel, and was an extremely successful entrepreneur in Boston. He was on the first plane and first victim. When he understood the plane was hijacked, he retaliated and fought the terrorists and was killed before the first plane struck the first tower. I knew Daniel. I met him in Boston a few years earlier and felt for him. As mayor of Jerusalem, I know you feel the same when terror strikes our city. There's a deep sense of empathy, of understanding, of friendship between our peoples. This profound connection is what led us, together with KKL, decide the place and make sure that the memorial, is based here in the city of Jerusalem. From here, we stand together with New York, with the United States of America, with shared values, shared purpose for creating a better world, sharing our pain together for the loss of our loved ones. And because we share these values together, we also stand with shared clear message of combating terror globally. The strategic goal of the terrorists who killed thousands on that fateful day in September was to destroy our way of life. They seeked to turn our streets into battlefields, our freedom into fear, and our unity into discord. They failed. They failed in New York, and they failed in Jerusalem. They failed in Paris, in Brussels, and around the globe. Hatred did not win 15 years ago. Hatred does not win today. Hatred and terror will fail in the future. Each time the terrorists seek to hurt us, to target our civilians, to strain our bonds and friendship around the world, we have stood together. We have shown terrorists that they will not tear us apart. They will not destroy our way of life. They will not win. On behalf of the residents of Jerusalem and the people of Israel, please convey our condolences to the families and friends, to the people of New York, and all the people of the United States of America. We stand together. We remember together. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I now invite Deputy Minister Michael Oren to deliver his remarks.
To the families, the bereaved families, Mishpachot Shechulot, to Ambassador Dan Shapiro, Mayor Barkat, to Ron Lauder, Mike Nisim, Keren Kayemet Yisrael, and JNF, the United States, thank you for keeping the memory of 9/11 alive in Israel in this way and to making this country so vibrant. To the representatives of Israel's security and police force and America's police force, thank you for all you do for protecting us. We're honored to have you here today. And friends, I think we've heard repeatedly that the immediate reaction of anybody, certainly of our generation, to the events of 9/11 was deeply personal. And I was no exception. September 2001, Israel was already a year into a bitter struggle against jihadist terrorists, generally called the Second Intifada. Rarely a day went by without suicide bombers striking some bus or restaurant or public place, killing and maiming hundreds of Israelis. My eldest son, Yoav, a graduate of a Jerusalem high school, and his friends were preparing to go into the army, and like many Israelis, before they go in the army, took a trip. And where did they go? To Lower Manhattan. On September 10th, my son called home and said, "Look, I got this picture. We're doing handstands on the top of the Twin Towers." And we were so excited about this that me and my buddies, we decided to go back the next morning. I have that picture, dated September 10th. The next morning, the next afternoon, I got a call from a good friend of mine at the US Embassy saying, "It looks like there's been a horrific terrorist attack in New York City. Two planes have struck the World Twin Towers. They're looking like they're about to collapse." They hadn't collapsed yet. And when the fog cleared in my mind, I thought, Yoav's on top of one of those towers. And I tried to call him, and all the phone lines had gone down. You remember this, trying to call New York that day? All the phone lines gone down, and there were hours of abject terror, until we actually got a hold of him. They had made the date not for 8:30 the next morning, but for 11:30 the next morning, and they were on a rooftop in southern Brooklyn watching and photographing the fall of the Twin Towers. We didn't know what was going on that then. He was crying. I told him to get down into a basement with a jerry can of water. Who knew what was coming next? Photograph, by the way, appears in a book I wrote about the history of American involvement in the Middle East. Credit to my son who took the photograph. When the personal trauma ended, I think all of us began to understand that we were entering a new world. I thought about my father, who was 16 years old on a certain Sunday in December 1941, listening to the radio and understanding that his world was about to change. I think we all understood that our world was going about to change, and that the struggle we were engaged in was not a struggle against an empire or even against a country, but a struggle against an idea. And it wouldn't take 4 years or 10 years or 15 years, but that struggle would be a generational struggle, at least one generation, if not more. We in Israel, and not only Israel, understood. We understood that the same type of evil that drives a human being to put on an explosive vest and get onto a bus full of civilians in Jerusalem is the same evil that drove two planes into the Twin Towers or into the Pentagon or into a field in Pennsylvania then. the same evil. The same evil that drives people to fire thousands of rockets into Israeli cities, at towns and schools and farms, is the same evil that drives people to cut off the heads of innocent American journalists and others in Iraq and Syria. It is the same evil. It is the same evil that drives terrorists to kidnap three Israeli teenagers and execute them mercilessly. It is the same evil. It is the same idea. And therefore, we convene here not only to remember, but to renew our commitment, to honor the memories of those who lost their lives on 9/11, who struggled so valiantly to try to save and locate any survivors. We honor them by continuing the struggle. And the struggle is to defend our common values, to defend our common societies, our common freedoms, which they sought to deny us. Our struggle is to defend our common freedom. That is why we will gather here today, and that is why we will continue as Americans, as Israelis, and as so many allies in the world, we will continue to fight. Thank you.
Thank you. We will pause for a moment to set up for the wreath-laying ceremony. Marine Detachment and Israeli firefighters will now assist in the wreath-laying ceremony with musical accompanied by Eyal Heyman and Bella Crescent playing Adagio by Vivaldi. To lay a wreath on behalf of the families of the September 11th victims and terror attacks around the world, Efrat Noam Avraham, brother and sister of Alona Avraham. May her memory be a blessing. Alona was in the South Tower when United Airlines Flight 175 struck it.
Ambassador Michael.
Israel Police Deputy Commissioner, will lay a wreath on behalf of the Israel National Police. Fire Chief Nissim Tuito, Acting Commander of the Jerusalem District, will lay a wreath on behalf of Israel Fire and Rescue Authority. Please rise as Julia Guliger, accompanied once again by Moriel Hoffman, leads the singing of Hatikva.
Never.